This video is about making an urn for the ashes of a friend's dad that had passed away recently. The basic shape of this urn is a box that I made with a screw advanced box joint jig, but in this video I'll focus more on the other details, such as the molding that I made for the box.
So I want to make some molding that goes on the bottom edge of this box, and I've made some prototype molding, which I think looks kind of nice, and I need to make more of this molding. What I'm doing is I'm actually making this using just router bits from one of these cheap router bit sets. So I'm cutting this shape in several passes. I start out with this particular bit here just to cut away some of the material, and then I'm using this bit to cut away this round shape here, and then last this bit here to cut away the rest of it, and that'll give me my nice molding shape.
I'm going to remove the material in two passes, so first I back off the router bit, cut that, and then adjust it to full depth and make a second pass. Now switching from the straight bit to the roundover bit. And now switching to the inside round bit or cove bit. And that finishes up the lower molding.
Now this is the shape of molding that I want to create for the top of the box, and it'll sit over the edge here, and then this lip here is going to cover up the lid that goes in there. Now in here I've got this inside curve, and I was first thinking I should cut it like this, but the problem is I have to extend my bit way above the router table. So I figured it would be better if I came at it like this. Now I could use a ball nose cutter like that, but the tip of these things really doesn't make such a good cut, so I'd rather not. So what I've done is I've taken the other one of these cutters, took the bearing off, and then ground it flat on here, so that I can reach in here like this from below. I've got two of these cutters, so it's okay to have one flat on top, because I think that's actually pretty useful for a lot of stuff. So I've got my modified bit set up to make this cut, and I've already cut a rabbit out of my pieces of stock so that this bit doesn't have to cut very much. So all it's really doing is just to cut that last little bit of round out of it. Next I need to cut this bevel here, and I've just set up my table saw to cut that. My table saw tilts right, so I have to cut this on the right side of the fence. Next I need to cut out this round here, and I've already hogged out most of it with the table saw. Finally, I need to cut this corner out here, and I'm just going to do that on the table saw, and I'm going to pass it over like this, and then the next cut I'll adjust it and I'll pass it over like this to make that second cut to cut out that rabbit. So I printed what I want to put on the lid of this box, and now I'm just rubbing it through with a pencil. So there's my printout, and I've got the layout transferred onto the wood.
So this was my first time carving lettering into wood. It was made trickier because I was actually using very hard maple, and most people tend to use much softer wood for that. I started by carving a vertical line in the middle of the letters, and then with 45 degrees from either side to cut out the V-notch along the paths of the letters. It's important to always cut so that you're cutting out of the grain so that you don't get extra chip out, which is why I have to turn the wood so often. To join the lid, I cut a whole bunch of notches around the edges of it, and I also cut a corresponding bunch of notches in the edges of the box with a router table.
So the way I'm joining this lid on here is it's going to sit in these notches here. And the whole lid is actually not glued in place at all, because that lid being cross-grained this way is liable to expand a little bit if humidity increases. So I've got quite a bit of slack here, so if the lid expands, it's not going to pop out the sides of this box. So I pre-finished the top of this box and the trim pieces, so that when I put these trim pieces on, I don't have to worry about getting finish in there. And that way, if the panel in here grows and expands, I'm not going to have any sort of finish edge that's going to show up. Now to fit these pieces of trim on, it's very important to get these miters all closed, and I'm using two of these pieces already cut to figure out exactly what length I need to cut this piece before I glue the next piece down. So here I need to cut to about here, and I'm going to leave a little bit of extra and then trim that to get it exactly on the table saw. I'm using my table saw sled to trim these pieces to size. I tried cutting this on the miter saw, but I just wasn't getting a clean enough cut. So if I put this on here with a spacer underneath, I can get it exactly level and then line it up with where the cut's going to be made.
I always had to let the glue dry after I attached one piece before I went to the next, so putting those pieces on took quite a bit of time. I used the same table saw sled and 45 degree angle to cut the trim for the bottom pieces. Before gluing on the bottom trim, I marked and then cut out on the bottom so that the ends of the rails would form sort of a leg. Gluing on the bottom pieces was much easier than gluing on the top pieces, because I could just secure everything with spring clamps. I reinforced the corners of the top trim with dowels. I made those dowels myself by whittling down a stick that I cut on the table saw. And the plywood lid for the bottom. The way I attached the trim on the bottom made for a nice rabbit ledge that I could screw the lid onto in such a way that it's not visible when the box is upright.